Simon & Schuster Audio presents Children of the Black Glass, Book 1 of Children of the Black Glass, by Anthony Peckham, read by Peter Noble. For Jay. Prologue. Seika already had more than enough black glass to take down the mountain and trade for the coming winter's needs. He knew he should have been wrapping and packing it, but a few days earlier he'd spotted a particular crevice high on the shining vein. He'd looked away from it instantly, never letting his one remaining eye find it again, in case the other men saw it too. To him, the shape and angle of the crevice hinted at a chance to cut the rarest of all pieces, a perfect, gleaming slab, so thin it was almost see-through. These were called sorcerers' glass, because sorcerers craved them and would bid high for them. The men of their village dreamed constantly of such a piece and the wealth it would bring. But Seika also knew firsthand that sorcerer's glass was dangerous to cut, needing lots of force to cleave it perfectly from the mine face. As a young man, he'd lost his left eye to a flying shard while trying for one. With only one working eye, he knew exactly what he was risking, and he also knew that he had no choice. Sorcerer's glass would change any family's life forever, and theirs was a life that badly needed changing. 1. Tell and Wren, Seika's two children, had no idea of the risk he was about to take for them. They were far away on the mountainside, hunting for dinner, and dinner had just served itself up, if they could catch it. In a jumble of boulders above them, the very tip of a narrow ear flashed pink for a moment, backlit by the low sun. There. That was all Tell needed to see. He already had an arrow knocked to the string, because he always did when they were out hunting. Just below him, on the path, Wren knew by the way her brother stopped and curled his scarred fingers to the bow that he'd seen something worth taking. She had a good idea what it was. When he turned to her, she wiggled two fingers above her head, making rabbit ears. He shrugged yes. Wren pulled a face. Ugh, mountain jackrabbits were lean and tough, like every living thing up there, including themselves. Wren tapped her chest, pointed upward. Tell nodded and took off up the path, as silent as smoke. Even at 14, he was one of the best hunters in the village and brought in most of the meat they ate. He could have taken the jackrabbit by himself, but this way was quicker. Also, they liked working together. Instead of circling back along the trail, Wren climbed straight up the low cliff separating them from the terrace above. The way she scaled the rock wall made it look as easy as walking. And for her, it was. She was born to it. As a baby, she'd climbed the stone walls inside their hut as soon as she was old enough to pull herself upright. She had long, strong fingers, plus a jagged scar on her leg from a fall when she was just 3. But then everyone in their village had scars of some kind. Wren was barely breathing hard when she slid up over the cliff edge onto the rocky terrace. She stayed on her belly until she heard the grinding sound of the jackrabbit chewing on a mouthful of spiny grass. She stood up, slowly and calmly, looking everywhere but at the jackrabbit, because all animals can feel eyes on them, especially animals that are hunted regularly. Then, not bothering to muffle her footsteps, she walked across the terrace, not toward the jackrabbit, just away from the cliff edge. The jackrabbit stood up on its back legs, instantly alert. Wren sighed. This one was particularly skinny, a gamey old male. She could tell by the shape of his underslung jaw, even with just one fleeting sideways glance. Because she wasn't looking directly at it, and because she wasn't getting any closer, the jackrabbit didn't flee instantly. It stayed upright, alert, and ready to bolt if necessary. Not alert enough. Not ready enough. The hiss thud of an arrow let her know that her brother's shot had found its target. She finally looked directly at the jackrabbit, as it succumbed with hardly a twitch.
"Not a bad shot?"
Wren teased. "I like it when they don't know what happened to them." Tell nodded. He knew a good hunter made sure his prey didn't suffer. Plus, the meat tasted better that way. There was no question they were brother and sister. They shared the same generous mouths and prominent fine-bridged noses, a very visible part of their family inheritance. They'd been teased endlessly when they were younger.
"Is that a mountain peak or your nose? Be careful of that blade on your face, it might cut somebody."
But as they grew older and bigger, their noses became less of a landmark and more just interesting.
"Are you coming back down?"
Wren asked as she slung the still warm animal around her neck and tied its feet together with a twist of grass. A familiar scowl settled across Tell's angular face, one that had been there for almost 2 years. He pointed up the mountain, away from the village.
"I'll try for more," he said,
then set off without looking back. Wren sadly watched him go. She knew that hunting was just his excuse to stay away, especially that day. But she had no such excuse. She headed back fast, leaping from rock to rock until she reached the edge of the canyon. She paused to look down at the village directly below. Her entire world, her entire life so far, all 12 years of it. This was her favorite view, and in truth, she scarcely had to look, she knew it so well, and it changed so little. About 30 or so familiar stone huts were arranged along both walls of the canyon, at a place where it widened slightly, and an ice-cold spring gurgled from a crack in the rock. The huts faced each other at various angles, depending on the vagaries of the rock, and they'd been built in all sorts of shapes. Her village had many rules, but none about the shape of your house. The rock determined that. The huts all leaned against the canyon wall for the strength to withstand winter's heavy snow. With the canyon behind them, thick rock walls all around, and slate roofs above their heads, theirs was a life lived in stone, most of it cold. No trees worth the name grew this high. The timbers that supported their roofs had been carried up the mountain one by one long ago, and were by far the most valuable part of any home. Wren and Tell's was a sturdy rectangle on the high side of the village. Seeing it always gave her a solid feeling. It got more sunlight than any other, especially late in the day, and Wren was proud that it was considered one of the most comfortable and well-built in the village. The small summer garden she'd started years ago with her mother had gone to seed, and looking down on it, Wren made a mental note to gather the seeds before the first snow arrived. It would be soon, she knew, and once it arrived, their world of rock would become a world buried in snow and ice. Voices bounced up the rock from below, clear as bells in the thin air, and Wren recognized every single one, no matter their age. Little kids were yelling or crying as they played one of their endless games, which usually ended when someone threw a stone and someone else didn't duck fast enough. Women were shouting at the children, and across the canyon at their friends or enemies. There was an extra edge to their voices today. They should have rung with excitement and urgency, because the mules were being readied for the long journey down to halfway. But instead, Wren heard frustration, anger, and envy in the women's voices, and she knew exactly why. Because for the second year in a row, they weren't going.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.